Hey guys, what the heck is up? Welcome back to my channel and welcome back to another true crime video. Today's case is on a 19-year-old girl named Tara Calico that went missing and her case still remains unsolved. Originally, when I began to research this, it seemed like a very simple missing persons case, but the more and more details I read about it, the more twisted this became. Lee Calico was born February 28, 1969 in Belen, New Mexico. Tara lived with her mother and her stepfather, and she was just 19 years old when she went missing. Tara was described by her friends and family as beaming of enthusiasm and just a very overall cheerful person. Her stepfather quoted that there was so much she wanted to do in a day. She was like a machine and it was amazing. She had graduated from Belen High School and then continued her education at the University of New Mexico. When she went missing, she was a sophomore there and her dream was to study something in psychology. Tara went missing on September 20th, 1988. It was a Tuesday morning. Tara left her house around 9:30 in the morning to do her bike ride that she did almost every single day. This bike ride was 36 to 37 miles. Insane. It's a big deal if I walk a mile or two. I can't believe that that was her daily routine. But normally she would leave around 9 in the morning and she had left a little bit late in the day. Before leaving on her bike ride, she told her mom, which looking back is a bit eerie, if I'm not home by 12, please come pick me up. This was because she had plans with her boyfriend around 12:30 to play tennis before she had work later that day. So you can tell by just that sentence that Tara was just very, very busy, very active, just so many things, and she just had started her day a little bit late for her bike ride. The route that she would take every day was on New Mexico Road 47. Her mom actually used to ride this route with her. However, I'm sorry if I'm saying route instead of route, if that's triggering you. I'ma stick to it though. But her mom would always ride this with her, but her mom had recently stopped as she felt like she was being followed and was just uncomfortable with it. So she also suggested that Tara, if she were to continue the rides, took Mace with her. Tara did not like that idea and did not follow through with it. So when her daughter was not home around noon, about 12:05, Tara's mother got into the car to go find Tara and pick her up. She drove the entire route and did not find Tara at all. So she took it again, just drove around, maybe she missed her. When she did not find her for the second time is when police were contacted. The last person who had seen Tara was a woman named Annie, and it was around 11:30 noonish in Valencia County, which was close to her home city in New Mexico. The next day, her mom found her cassettes as well as her Sony Walkman around mile marker 16. She also saw some bike skid marks, which was alarming to her because she thought that showed a sign of struggle. She also did think that Tara had maybe thrown the cassette in the Sony to leave a trail as to where she was being taken or heading. There were numerous witnesses that had seen Tara riding her bike that day but had nothing alarming to say. They didn't see any abduction, any struggles, anything like that, but a couple did notice that there was a light colored truck, potentially a Ford, following her, but no one saw anything happen with it. A few people had claimed that they had seen Tara in the southern part of the United States, but none of those sightings were ever confirmed, and the case kind of went cold for a while. It was 9 months later, on June 15th, 1989, that the first lead, kind of, I guess, was discovered. What it was a Polaroid photo found in a convenience store parking lot in Port St. Joe, Florida, about 1,500 miles from where Tara had gone missing. What was found was a Polaroid of a woman and a boy gagged up, tied up in the back of a car. This girl had a scar on her leg that was almost identical, if not identical, to Tara's scar on her leg that she had gotten in a car accident. The woman who found the Polaroid had found it next to a windowless Toyota van. They had a description of a male in his 30s that had gone into the van. They set up stops and things to try to catch this person, and unfortunately the man or the van were never identified. So this photo, when it was found and given in, they sent it into Polaroid and they analyzed the photo. They said that the film that was taken, the photo was taken with, was a new film, so this photo would not have been taken before May of 1989, which only gave about a month, month and a half window in between when the film was released and when this photo would have been taken. This photo was broadcasted on A Current Affair in July, so a little bit after it was found, and that is when Tara's mom was notified by her friends that the girl in the photo looked like it could potentially be her. This is when the little boy's family also came forward to identify him. His name was Michael Henley and he also was from New Mexico. And he had disappeared in April of 1988. Both of the families met with investigators to confirm that they were the ones in the photos. This is when the scar was pointed out that I had mentioned. And her mom also mentioned that the book next to her in the photographs was her all-time favorite book. The book was called My Sweet Adrena. So they had this Polaroid analyzed by so many different places. The Scotland Yard actually analyzed it and said that there was an 85% chance that Tara was the girl in the photos. However, Los Alamos Laboratory disagreed with that. The FBI also did their investigation on the Polaroid and it came back inconclusive. They did find a phone number on the book in the Polaroid. However, we've all used Polaroids, and especially back then, they were probably even less clear. It was small, it was a little bit blurry, it was hard to read the full number. So there was about 350 different combinations of phone numbers that could have been in the Polaroid. Out of those 350 numbers, 57 were active lines, and nothing really came from the calls, at least to public knowledge. So then everything kind of went cold again until June of 1989 when another photograph was found. However, this photograph was found in Montecito, California. It was a picture of a girl. It will be on the screen. She again was gagged in duct tape on a blue pillow that was very similar to the original Polaroid found. The girl in this photo had a lazy eye and also a calic, which Tara also had. So again, her mother was convinced that this was her as well. Another photograph appeared in February of 1990. This was a photo of a girl gagged, bound on a train with a male. This, her mom said she could not tell if this was her or not, and this was deemed a prank photo, which is not cool. Michael's parents also were for sure that it was him in the photograph. However, his remains were found in 1990 in the Zuni Mountains, which was about 7 miles from where Michael had originally disappeared. The police deemed that he actually passed away from exposure and that he had just accidentally wandered away from his family and passed away before he could be found or find his way back to them. So that had actually ruled him out of being the little boy in the Polaroid. So then the case kind of quieted down for a while until June of 2009, where one of the sheriffs had an announcement about Tara's case. He stated that he knew that what had happened to her, that two boys saw Tara on her bike ride and started harassing her. They accidentally hit her, so in fear they took her from the scene. This is when she threatened to get both of them in trouble. They panicked and killed her. This announcement also stated that the boys had buried her close to her route. However, a body had never been found. In October of 2013, a 6-person task force was created to help solve Tara's case. So this is where things get kind of weird. Although there was never any suspects that were openly discussed, Tara's case files were released in public records. There was 22 pages of them, and we're going to go over a couple of the records. So the first file was dated April 18th, and it actually mentioned 3 suspects, which is very surprising. As I just mentioned, no suspects were ever discussed with the public. These suspects were Lawrence Romero Jr., Dave Silver, and Leroy Chavez. This report also mentioned that there was a gravesite, however, no charges were ever filed. Another file was dated April 15th, 2010. This was about a female who wanted to investigate the disappearance of Tara. She was a former classmate of her, so there was an attachment to the case, and she just wanted to document it. She had actually reported to the police that she started to feel unsafe while investigating. She felt like she was being followed by people, and she reported it to the police. This file had mentioned the three males from the previous case on it. It did state, though, that one of them was now deceased. This woman also mentioned to the police that she thinks that Tara had a hit on her. Nothing was ever done with that because it was just more hearsay than factual. The last records I'm going to discuss are from November 6th, 2013, and the ones where this just gets a bit weird. This was an interview with Valencia County, the county that I mentioned previously in this case that was near her house. One of the last times she was spotted was in Valencia County. This was an interview with the former sheriff deputy there. It was Deputy Frank Mathola, who had followed up with a couple leads from Tara's case previously. This specific incident that I'm going to be talking about is an interview he had with somebody on their deathbed named Henry Brown, who stated he wanted to make a confession prior to passing away. This confession had stated that shortly after the disappearance of Tara Calico, he was at someone's house in their basement and noticed a woman wrapped up in a blue tarp in a makeshift grave. The weird thing about where he had spotted this deceased girl and the makeshift grave, it was at Lawrence Romero Jr.'s house. And the other two males that had been mentioned earlier in the case were also at the house when Henry had seen the body. The three males confessed to him about everything that had happened that day with Tara. He was not comfortable coming forward prior to this because they threatened to kill him if he ever mentioned it. The boys stated that they knew Tara's route, they had followed her, hit her with their car, and then essentially tortured her and killed her. This all happened in gravel pits off her typical route. She had again threatened, just like she did with the story of the two boys, to get them all caught, and they panicked and killed her. The weirdest thing about this story is it's very similar to the one talked about previously in 2009, but with the three males versus the two boys. The men had placed her deceased body into a bush, however moved it to their basement when her investigations began. Now, the catch to all of this is Lawrence Romero Jr. was the son of the sheriff. So with that being said, everything now kind of seems like a cover-up. It's believed that Sheriff Romero hired a different sheriff named Sheriff Rivera to help cover up the murder of Tara Calico. Also in 2003, another eyewitness named Donald Dutcher had stated that the three males also had completely come clean to him about the situation as well and everything that they had done. So Lawrence Romero Jr. actually passed away. They're unsure if this is by suicide or rumor has it may have been Russian roulette. Either way, there is a note that he wrote coming clean to everything that he did in regards to the disappearance of Tara. The only issue with this is it was never documented in her case and they can't find it, which is just, again, everything towards the end of this case. It seems like they know exactly what happened, but that it's a complete police cover-up. Sheriff Mathola obviously looked into this case further due to some conflict, I believe, with Sheriff Romero. He ended up resigning from being a sheriff. So I had read that the case closed, but I also read something that recently, in October of 2019, the FBI came forward and said that they would offer $20,000 for anyone that could lead them to the body of Tara, anything, clues to finding out what happened to Tara, clues to the people who did this to her, just anything that can get them closure. Her mother and stepfather have since passed. However, she has a stepsister who is still very determined to solve the case of her stepsister. She just wants closure. At this point, she doesn't think that she's alive, but she just wants to put her stepsister to rest and be able to fully close this chapter and heal from it and move on. Something I did think was really cool is one of her friends actually has a podcast. It's called Vanished, and it's actually allowed new information about this case to emerge, and they are working closely with the police with all the new details that they are able to find to hopefully get this case closed and bring Tara to rest. So on that note, I will link anything about this case down below if you want to read into it more. Thank you guys so much for watching. Don't forget to thumbs up and subscribe, and I will see you guys so soon for another video. Goodbye.